Hi, my name is Rebecca Lise. This is a pre-recorded presentation for the 2020 meeting of the Society for Mathematical Psychology. Today, I'm going to talk to you about prediction error and surprise. Every day, we make predictions about what things are going to look like and sound like and feel like. Predictions are important because they allow us to prepare for events. We can focus on what might potentially be important because it is unexpected, surprising, and unknown. But an event can only be identified as unexpected if there is an expectation or a prediction to begin with, and if there is a large enough deviation from that prediction. Now, large enough must be a statistical judgment, because there is random variation in events themselves, in our perception of events, and in our predictions. So you need to be able to disregard errors in your predictions that occur due to random variation. So we need to have a criterion for how large a prediction error must be to constitute evidence that something surprising and unknown is happening. If that criterion is inappropriate, or if you systematically misjudge the size of your prediction error, then this may result in a shift in the balance between type 1 and type 2 errors. So either people get too laid back and they fail to notice when things change, or they keep being surprised by mere random fluctuations. To examine this further, imagine that you need some wire rope and you want to know if it's still safe to use. You see some rope lying in your garage, but you can't see the rope clearly because of the dim lights. The width of the distribution reflects the uncertainty that comes from not seeing the rope clearly. So you try to recollect what rope is supposed to look like, but perhaps your memory is a bit vague. Then the prediction error, the statistical difference between what you expect to see and what you actually see, might not worry you. They may look a bit different, but given the dim light and the vague memory, that difference is not unreasonable. That same physical difference might worry you more if your memory was more precise, and you could remember more clearly what a rope is supposed to look like. Also, if you looked more closely at the rope, maybe using a magnifying glass, then you could be more confident that what you're seeing is actually correct. We still have the same physical difference between the predicted rope and the observed rope, but the prediction error is now larger because there is less uncertainty. Additionally, if you were using the rope to go hang gliding, you might be even more concerned about that difference. So we have to distinguish between differences measured in physical units, how statistically surprising that difference is, and that's the prediction error, and how much we care about any particular surprise. That is called the surprise threshold or the surprise sensitivity. And where you set that threshold should depend partly on the situation, like if you're going hang gliding, but it should also depend on your subjective evaluation of the consequences of surprise. So for our project, we wanted to look at prediction error because a large enough prediction error is surprising enough to indicate that the world has changed to such an extent that new learning is needed. Van der Kruse and colleagues argued that the preference for predictability and routine in autism occurs because frequent surprise constantly triggers new learning, which becomes overwhelming. Excessive surprise has also been linked to psychosis by Frith, who argued that being frequently surprised by the outcome of one's own actions leads to the inference that one is not in control of one's body. Combine with the over-attribution of intent and you get the illusion of control. These authors do not discuss surprise threshold, but instead argue that excessive surprise occurs because of misestimation of prediction error. In other words, if people consistently misjudge the precision of their memory or their sensory data, they end up getting more surprised than they should be. So we wanted to create a simulation where we varied both the misestimation of prediction error and the criterion for surprise, and then calculate how often do people get surprised. So, how do we simulate misestimation? We have a prediction and a sensory data with standard deviation that reflect reality. That is the graph in the middle. Then we vary the perceived standard deviation by a factor of 4. So for the prediction, if you perceive your standard deviation to be 2, then there is no misestimation because it matches the real prediction. But if you perceive it as 4, then you overestimate the uncertainty in your memory or prediction. If it is 1, you underestimate the uncertainty. Same for sensory data. The actual standard deviation is 1, so if you perceive it as 2, then you overestimate the uncertainty in your data. If it is 0.5, you underestimate the uncertainty in your data. We also generated trials where there was an average difference between the prediction and the sensory data. We have included 2 models of memory, and they relate to how you make your predictions. So first, we have the exemplar model, where we draw from a distribution of memories. We model prediction based on the average of either 2, 8, or 32 samples. We also included a prototype model, where the prediction is fixed. In the literature, you have different ways of calculating the prediction error. One way is treating it as an effect size, which is what the authors who discuss misestimation psychosis do. Others look instead at divergences between distributions, which comes in 2 flavors. One is the prediction distribution or prior distribution versus the sensory data distribution. And the second is the prediction versus the posterior distribution. The KL divergence is usually calculated using the asymmetrical function. This means that the function is not symmetrical with regard to the distributions that are compared. And therefore, you would get different outcomes if you change the order of the comparison. The implication of this is that the uncertainty of one of the distributions will carry more weight than the uncertainty of the other. Now, it might be that the uncertainty of both distributions should carry equal weight, and we therefore included both the asymmetric and the symmetric version of the KL divergence. And finally, we added surprise threshold. So what we're asking here is, what matters the most when it comes to how often I get surprised? Is it misestimating the precision of my memory or my data? Is it the actual difference between what I predict and observe? Is it based on how I make my predictions? Does it matter how I calculate the prediction error? And does it matter how low or high my threshold for being surprised is? So the results for 10,000 trials show that surprise threshold had the greatest effect on how often you get surprised. It is larger than mean difference, so threshold matters more than the difference between your prediction and your experience. Importantly, threshold matter more than misestimating the uncertainty in your prediction or your data. Models of memory and prediction error models did not produce any noteworthy effect sizes. But it is interesting when you look at some of the interactions. Although they did not produce any large effect sizes, these graphs suggest that when it comes to theories of misestimation in psychosis and autism, it may be important how you choose to calculate your prediction error. So in the end, I want to mention that when it comes to surprise threshold, we have a gap in the literature. Importantly, it is rarely discussed in the context of excessive surprise in psychosis and autism. This is important because this simulation indicates that surprise threshold might have a greater effect on behavior than misestimation. In fact, our results suggest that how sensitive you are to surprises might matter more than how accurate your predictions are. I want to thank my collaborators, Robert Biglin and Gerrit Fuhl. Again, my name is Rebecca Lise, and I want to thank you for your attention.